Chief Operating Officer of Keppel Offshore and Marine. Mr. Chow, please.
Mr. Teo, Chairman, SMI, fellow panelists, and distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, very good morning. Today, I'm pleased to be able to share with you on the outlook for the offshore sector and how Singapore's role and how we can play a part in the sector's growth. It has been mentioned by Mr. Teo that Singapore has built about 70% of the world jack-up rigs and more than 50% of the semi-submersible rig since the year 2000. And we have also been the leader in the conversion of floating production storage and offloading vessels called FPSO. And today we actually have about 60% of the market share in the world. And why did that happen? Actually, customers come to Singapore because we have carved a reputation for consistently delivering products of high quality in a safe and timely manner. The country has also produced a suite of technologically advanced rigs designed that have become widely accepted in the industry. Over the years, the offshore industry has its share of up and down. In my career, at least I've seen three cycles. Up to the middle of 2004, the industry was in a prolonged industry downturn. When the building boom arrived, it was interrupted again by the global financial crisis in 2008-2009. However, Singapore Yards has weathered that storm well, and we have had a good backlog of orders built up from 2006 to 2011. Now, despite the downturn, we continue to build up our capabilities and we seize opportunity as they come along. In late 2010, we began to see the recovery, the industry recovery, as the market still needs new rigs, having endured underinvestment over the past 20 years. Today, there are about 80 jack-up rigs on order worldwide, of which 51 of them are built in the Singapore Yards. And Singapore Yards are building 8 of the 32 semi-submersible rigs on order. But actually for us, for semi-submersible rig, out of that 32, we have actually 6 of them that will be built in Brazil. And I think for Sembcorp Marine, they have 6 drill ships that will also be built in Brazil. Now, as far as the global economic climate is concerned, despite that uncertainties, the oil and gas sector has remained robust. And this is based on the steady oil price. The US economy is showing some sign of recovery, but we are looking carefully at what is termed the fiscal cliff, and what implication that has to our industry. Because with a fiscal cliff, with increased taxation and reduced the deficit, what it means is that economic activity in the US will decline. And that has a big impact to the demand of energy in that market. The demand for energy, in our opinion, will continue to grow worldwide. And this is partly, in no small way, due to population growth. The world population will grow and increase by more than 25% from 2010 to 2040. And because of the greater wealth, particularly in the middle income group, middle class, in places like India and China, Brazil, Russia, there is demand for more energy, and that is a very important part of the equation. Now, this demand is driving a new wave of exploration and production of oil by oil companies in deep drilling in shallow water. As you know, shallow water, it has been traditionally, you know, been the first offshore region for exploration. But now, with new technology, we are able to drill deeper. And so we have to contend with high temperature, high pressure regime, and that is for the shallow water. But we are also going into the deep, the new deep water fields, and in harsher environment. So in addition to that, the high oil prices over the last few years has resulted in a new cycle of investment, and it looks set to continue. This may not necessarily be very good news for our friends in the shipping industry, but I think in the offshore industry, our prediction is that, you know, the oil price will continue to increase. And according to Macquarie's estimate, today Brent crude price is expected to stay above US $105 per barrel and will gradually increase to US $118 per barrel. Of course, we've got to take it with a pinch of salt. Today I just checked the oil price, crude oil prices. The WTI price today is about $86 and Brent is at $109.5 US dollars. We also believe that E&P spending in 2012 and going forward, particularly in 2012, the total E&P spending worldwide by oil company is forecast to be close to $600 billion. The strong demand for oil and gas augurs well for Singapore companies in the offshore and marine sector. Now let's look at some trends in the offshore sector. There is an aging rig fleet, and because of that, there is a drive for a new cycle of replacement. Half of the existing fleet is more than 25 years old. Other than being inefficient, many of these rigs cannot operate in more complicated and deep water conditions. Now, in addition, new jack-up rigs or floaters with higher capability helps to actually reduce the total cost of exploration because they are much more efficient than the older ones. In the deep water and harsh environment, the development of deep water and ultra deep water field is rapidly increasing as the shallow water discovery becomes depleted. The era of easy oil, in our opinion, is over. So, DNB North's market, actually in their research notes that there is going to be a strong growth in the number of fields that are on stream. And these are the fields that are in 5,000 feet of water and beyond. And Douglas Westwood, another research entity, expects that $29 billion of expenditure in deep water in the Asia-Pacific region alone over the next 5 years. As some of you may know, that today the amount of oil that's produced from offshore fields amounts to about 8 million barrels a day, and by 2025, it will reach 15 million barrels per day. Areas where offshore activities are very proliferate includes the Golden Triangle in the Atlantic Basin, which makes up of Brazil, West Africa, and the Gulf of Mexico. But of course, we have recent years have found massive, the industry have found massive gas discovery in East Africa. Now, more sophisticated rigs are then needed as more oil discovery are made in deep water offshore frontiers, where operations are more complex and the environmental conditions are harsher. The Macondo incident in the Gulf in 2010 underscored the need for modern assets equipped with the latest safety features and technology. We also see, probably due to global warming, perhaps, there are more hurricanes and more typhoons around the world. So offshore assets needs to be able to withstand or evade such storm in a very timely manner. So, with customized rig design, drilling contractors can have the flexibility to incorporate unique features to reduce environmental impact while addressing technological changes in drilling equipment and processes. As the industry rapidly expands into deep waters and harsh environment, we must keep up with this development by evolving our designs, enhancing our solutions with the latest requirement and preferences. The modern jack-up rig will be expected to drill faster, be more cost-effective, robust, and well-suited to operate in various parts of the world, such as the UK, the Norwegian sector of the North Sea, and other European sector in the North Sea. There have also been advancement in harsh environment floaters, which will be required to work in ultra-deep water of more than 10,000 feet to now presently there's the requirement to 12,000 feet and perhaps requirement to even 15,000 feet. And operating pressure from 10,000 PSI to 15,000 PSI and now to 20,000 PSI and even some are talking about 25,000 PSI. Now the other thing that has been mentioned also by my fellow panelists is about local content. This is a major trend in the offshore industry and has been rising in importance because of the importance, the rise of the national oil companies, which are increasingly placing local content demands on assets such as rigs and offshore vessels that are deployed in projects in their own territorial waters. NOC now account for the largest portion of E&P spending. And according to the DNB Markets research, 42% of E&P spending in 2012 will come from the NOCs. And only 37% of E&P spending will come from oil companies or oil majors. It is therefore helpful to the customer now more than ever that we need to prepare to go to where they operate to support their operations. And this is particularly evident in places like Brazil, with Brazil demanding between 50 to 70% local content, shipyard and supporting services have started setting up operation there. It is a market that companies in Singapore as well in Asia can benefit from. Already the number of new yards have set up there and they will need a strong supporting marine clusters and infrastructure to be successful. Actually, as a result of Petrobras' most recent tender of 28 drilling rigs, Singapore yards received 12 of those rigs as well as several FPSO topside fabrication and integration projects. Next subject for me is productivity. While there are many opportunities in the offshore sector, there is very stiff competition in terms of the number of ship and rig building yards around the world. Today we know that the Chinese and the Korean yards are very hungry because of the slowdown in the merchant shipping industry. In a market where financing has been impacted by the Eurozone crisis, cost competitiveness is a significant differentiator between winning or losing a job. And we need to continue to improve the processes and productivity levels in our shipyards. For us in Singapore, the scarcity of land and the tightening of the foreign worker quota provides an additional impetus for us to find new ways to further improve our productivity. We can do this through innovative building processes and leveraging technology to be more efficient. And this is a key driver in enabling us to maintain our safe and on time and within budget delivery, which obviously will help to reduce the number of man hours that are required to work on those projects. Even as the offshore and marine industry grows, there is an acute shortage of skilled personnel. We should look to develop a constant pool of talent. For example, Keppel has been working with schools and universities to provide scholarship as well as courses and seminars to increase the knowledge and technology capital in Singapore. It is important that we support and collaborate with the government and industry to attract, nurture, educate, and develop a healthy pipeline of skilled engineers and technicians. Today, the offshore marine and marine offshore industry in Singapore employs about 80,000 workers, and we account for a total annual output of about 13.6 billion Singapore dollars. Besides being cost competitive, staying relevant in the industry also means developing win-win solutions for the market. Earlier this year, Keppel Offshore and Marine Technology Centers and ConocoPhillips announced plans to jointly design a first-of-its-kind ice-worthy jack-up rigs to operate in the Arctic seas. When treading into the unknown, collaboration with like-minded partners is a way to reduce R&D costs and leverage each other's expertise to develop a breakthrough for the market. Many companies also look to collaboration with universities and research centers around the world. For instance, Keppel is in the process of setting up a technology center in Brazil where we can tap on the resources and technical competencies of some of the researchers and professors in the Brazilian university. Now, this is a very important initiative because we need to have peripheral knowledge about industry. Our young engineers and technicians need to have that. Because when you have enough peripheral knowledge about the industry, then you know what are the areas where you want to improve, where are the areas that you should spend time to research on. So this is what we are encouraging our people to do, to go out to conferences worldwide, to attend lectures, to attend seminars, offshore technology exhibitions, so that they can build up their peripheral knowledge, and with that, I think they will have a better understanding of where to come from. Our involvement with Brazil is actually through SEMPES, which is a research institute for Petrobras R&D, and it is through the discussion with them that we understand the challenges that they face in their pre-salt field development, and it is through that understanding that we are able to offer some solutions to them. So in conclusion, Singapore's success as an international maritime center is a result of strong support from the government and industry partners in building up a comprehensive infrastructure and vibrant marine cluster here. A favorable tax law, efficient processing systems, and importantly skilled professionals have played a very important role. For Singapore to move up the technology value chain in the offshore and marine industry, we also need to tap top R&D centers and develop our own intellectual property. From all indication, the fundamentals of offshore sector will remain strong for years to come, so that the industry will need new technologies and innovation, and I think Singapore is in a good position to develop the right solutions. Thank you very much.